Linwood? Am I audible?
Yes, yes. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Yes,
ma'am. May I start now?
Yes, yes.
May I start now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, audible.
Yes, yes, Pindavid, you are audible?
Okay. Good afternoon to everyone present here. Respected chairperson, Dulen Sekia sir, Dr. Dulen Sekia sir, principal and secretary of Jorhat Kendriya Mahavidyalaya. Respected convener, Mrs. Ili Fukan ma'am, academic vice principal and head of the Department of Zoology of Jorhat Kendriya Mahavidyalaya. Distinguished speaker, respected coordinators, respected faculty members, and dear participants. It is my pleasure to welcome all of you to the fourth technical session of National Workshop titled Remote Access to Lab on Screen. In continuation of the workshop on virtual lab, all of you have gathered the idea about how to carry on practicals through a virtual platform. Accordingly, this session is based, this technical session will be based on chemical science, that is chemistry. Before going to initiate this session, I would like to take the opportunity to give an introduction of distinguished speaker, Professor Paritosh Mandal sir. At present, Professor Paritosh Mandal sir is the head of the Department of Chemistry of Assam University, Silchar. Currently, he is involved in a broad area of research activity, specifically reaction mechanism, quantum chemistry, molecular modeling, hybrid quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics methods, etc. In addition to this, he is a professional evaluator of various manuscripts related to his field of research. He is also a member of scientific societies such as Assam Science Society, Indian Society for Surface Science and Technology. Thank you, sir, for being with us despite of your busy schedule, and we are fortunate enough to have you among us. Now, I would like to request Professor Paritosh Mandal sir to carry on his presentation. Over to you, sir. Please proceed.
Thank you, madam. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you for your kind introduction. Myself, Paritosh Mandal, teaching chemistry, basically chemistry at Assam University. And incidentally, of Jorhat Kendriya Mahavidyalaya, Mr. Vinod Hajarika. He has been my past best student at Assam University. Well, Vinod actually requested me to speak on the webinar organized by Jorhat Kendriya Mahavidyalaya. Though I have little expertise on this field, but I happily agreed with his proposal. As we are running through a very complicated situation, this situation created by the COVID-19, and with all other things, academic activities of the student as well as the faculty members are worst affected. And in this scenario, UGC along with other bodies, they are taking initiative to minimize the loss of the students. And by doing so, this UGC initiated this online lab facilities to the students so that the loss can be minimized. As we understood already that COVID-19 actually has created a problem. But sometimes we can think that it has also given some opportunities. As we understood that before COVID-19, we used to, even a simple thing, we used to visit the barber shop to set our hair. But during the COVID-19, we are confined to our house. So we could understood or learn how to set our hair also. Similarly, in academic purpose, particularly for academic, this theory papers are well taken in the online mode, but only practical portion of our syllabus is badly affected. So as this conference is organized, or this webinar is organized, the topics is very interesting, and it is really will be helpful. The deliberation of this webinar will be really helpful to the learner, particularly the students, right? So I will be sharing some slide here. Is it visible?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So in this virtual webinar, actually, my topics I have selected like this: virtual laboratory and its utility in chemistry. So particularly, I will be talking about mostly on chemistry. So in this first slide, what I have seen, I have presented here, this access from home. That means we can perform some experiment from home with the connection of internet. With a, here I have given a server center. So basically, this slide is created keeping in mind of the computational chemistry research particular. So anyway, before going to the main topic, I like to show something about the experimental activities, that is practical laboratories, about the practical laboratory of an institute. And if you go to any practical laboratory, the chemistry practical lab, you will encounter or see all this instrument, equipment, IR spectroscopy, microscope, UV visible spectroscopy, magnetic stirrer, NMR spectroscopy, and the laboratory space. So these are the basic missing minimum requirement to carry out a practical class in the institute. But as this moment, as we are unable to attend the physical class with the universities or the colleges or the schools, then how can we contribute, or how can we learn the practical classes? So as we understood that practical, the physical laboratory, it contains many equipment, but virtually we can understand without performing the experiment. Without virtually, we can understand the chemistry, the practicals, or the principle involved in the practical chemistry can be understood virtually. So keeping that point in mind, so I like to show as the virtual, actually the virtual lab, how this virtual word comes into existence. The word virtual actually comes from a medieval Latin word, virtualis, meaning effective. That is, in the sense, having the effect of something without form or without going to actually physically taking the physical mode of the system. Similarly, the virtual laboratory is one where students interact with the experiment or activity, which is basically remote from the student. And at the point of time of their experiment, there has no immediate physical reality. So how it can be differentiated, I'd like to show. Here I have shown one student is performing the experiment. So this is the direct experiment. That is, the student is, or the learner is coming to the laboratory where he is performing the experiment. Similarly, in the another slide, if I show here, it is also the student or the learner is coming to the laboratory. Here, what happened? The microscope is controlled by the computer. That is, this experiment is computer-based experiment. Now, the important thing is that in this experiment, what happened? The microscope is connected to the computer through internet. That is, a person sitting from his house, he can operate or study or perform the experiment with the microscope in the institute or in the laboratory. So this is actually come under virtual laboratory. Actually, in before pandemic, we used to learn that some people are working from home. Actually, that from that very idea, the virtual laboratory thing is coming into existence. And then, why we should perform the experiment in the virtual lab? Because it provides remote access to the lab in various disciplines of science and engineering. This virtual lab would cater to the need of the student at the undergraduate level, postgraduate level, as well as the research school. As we also understood that we are using the computer, then we can actually manipulate the experiment, that we can gather more experience without going to the physical lab. Because we can perform the experiment by changing many parameters computationally. This would help actually in learning basic and advanced concepts through remote experimentation. And another very important thing of this virtual laboratory is that where the student can avail various tools of learning, including additional web resources, video lectures, animated demonstration, and even self-evaluation can also be part of it. And mostly, this physical lab are equipped with very costly equipment. So what we can do with virtual lab, we can share the costly equipment and resources which otherwise available to a limited number of users due to constraint on time or geographical distances. So here I have given one differentiation between real lab and virtual lab. And if you go to the cost of the real lab, typically the cost of establishing a real lab is very high. But if you go to the virtual lab, its cost is almost negligible. Only one computer along with internet connectivity is sufficient to perform the experiment. Similarly, the availability of the equipment in the physical lab, sometimes due to the busy schedule, it can be limited time space may be given. But the virtual lab basically designed where the learner can perform experiment into 24/7. And in the real lab, what can happen, what is the advantage? That there may be face-to-face interaction with the supervisor or with the teacher. But in virtual laboratory, what happened? It can be only interacted through presentation. And in the real lab, what happened? We require a trained person to operate the equipment. We can just only use the data generated by the trained person. But in the virtual lab, advantage of virtual lab is that we need only basic knowledge of computer operation so that we can perform the experiment virtually. But still, no other option left. The real lab is the best. But you can see the virtual lab is the second best because with taking the knowledge from the virtual lab, we can then perform the real lab experiment with less effort. So then what may be the benefit of the virtual lab? As we understood already, the virtual experiment can be conducted anytime, anywhere, without the help of computer, but computer interface is necessary. And also, minimum or no time is needed for equipment setup. And even wait time for the result is very minimum. But if you do an experiment in the physical lab, sometimes getting the data from the equipment is very difficult, it's time consuming. Similarly, in the virtual lab, you can say here, lesson safety issues, because we are not dealing with the dangerous chemicals. We only using the computer. So every student can participate actively in the experiment with the help of computer. And even number of seniors can be presented by the student. That is, the student can manipulate the experiment very easily. The student can repeat the experiment multiple times. And when the student receives prompt and personalized feedback. So what can happen due to the internet connectivity, though a student may be at the remote place, he can access the best laboratory in the country if he is allowed to join. Similarly, you can perform the experiment number of times. You can repeat the experiment if you are not happy with the experiment. Similarly, so in this partial experiment, advanced personal development is also possible. And we can introduce new equipment or new technique with the virtual experiment so that the learner can increase his confidence to perform the experiment. And even in this virtual experiment, it actually, there is a less risk in hazardous chemicals. And even it requires and the complex setup of the equipment is not necessary. And the result, what is obtained through virtual lab, is also reliable. Basically, in this discussion, I want to show basically two experiments, very simple experiment what we are performing from 10 plus 2 onward. And we also show some activity, how to identify the metal ion present in the without going to the laboratory, that is inside your house or home, and we'll try to show some live demonstration of demonstration in learning the reaction mechanism. So first of all, I'd like to show the acid base titration, which basically we are performing in the laboratory by taking the help of either burette or burette stand, pipette, conical flux, volumetric flux, standard acid solution, unknown base solution, some indicator, and some solvent is necessary. And basically what happened in acid-base titration, as we already understood, that it comes from Latin, the titration word, that comes from the Latin word, titulus, which means the title. That is, to determine the rank of a solution. The titration means the determination of the concentration or the rank of a solution with respect of water, whose pH is 7. So in this case, what happened? We are taking some solution in the conical flux. You may say unknown solution, unknown basic solution. Then you are adding acid solution from the burette. And from here, we can find out the concentration of unknown solution. This is the experimental setup what I have shown here. And during this time of pandemic, as we are unable to go to the laboratory, and this simple experiment we can perform in our house, in our home also. How we can perform this experiment? Just we have taken a calcium hydroxide solution. It can be, it is easy to get in your household. From home, you can gather it. And similarly, you take a syringe in place of burette. And we have taken here the indicator as a litmus paper. You can say blue litmus paper and red litmus paper. And the vinegar you can take. Vinegar is basically the acetic acid, 10% acetic acid. So what we can take with the help of this experimental setup, we can understand the acid-base titration. What happened here? We have taken the unknown basic solution in the conical flux. Then we are a certain amount of solution of basic solution is taken in the conical flux, and standard acid solution is taken or vinegar solution is taken in the syringe, and where from drop wise it is added to the conical flux, where a litmus paper is added as an indicator. Litmus paper, as we understood, in the basic solution, it is blue in color. You can see it is blue in color. And on adding acid dropwise, what will happen? At certain amount, adding certain amount of acid, you will get a red color of the litmus paper. That starting of the red color of the litmus paper, it indicates the neutral point. So from this experiment, we can find out the strength of the basic solution. And this experiment can also be repeated in your household by taking simple other substance. For example, you can say, take soft solution or washing soda. They are basic in nature. Similarly, you can take acid. What are the acid? The lemon juice you can take, turmeric juice you can take. And indicator, if your this litmus paper is not available, then you can take the extract of hibiscus rosa sinensis. It acts as an indicator to perform the acid base titration. What happened? Basically, the indicator, the extract of hibiscus rosa sinensis, you can just crush the paper, crush the hibiscus flower, and you just find taken out the juice. And that juice can be used as an indicator. As you understood that the juice of the hibiscus, it contains anthocyanin, and the color of the anthocyanin depends upon the pH of the anthocyanin. So it is pH dependent, color is exhibited by anthocyanin. So what happened here, in basic solution, basically this hibiscus solution, the anthocyanin, shows very dark green color. And in acidic solution, it becomes little reddish in color, red in color. And in the neutral point, as the extra raw extract of hibiscus flower, it is basically reddish color. So with the help of hibiscus and with the taking of soda and lemon juice, we can perform this titration. Therefore, you can get the idea that you can find out the strength of the unknown solution, unknown acid solution or known solution, with the help of another known or unknown solution. So from this setup, this experiment can be performed very easily in everybody's house. Similar, perform another experiment. We want to show another experiment where the metal ion can be detected with the help of flame test. The flame test is a very important test is performed in the chemistry laboratory. And for performing this flame test, what are the objective, what are the substance necessary? Basically, it requires platinum or nickel chromium alloy wire, hydrochloric acid. It requires Bunsen burner, and it requires salt, which to be tested, what is the metal ion present in the salt, and it requires beaker, petri dish, and testing. And basic principle of this flame test is that if the chemical substance is heated, it will excite it to higher energy state. If the substance is unstable at the higher energy state, it will again come back to the ground state by releasing energy in the visible range. So that visible range actually gives the color. So therefore, what is the color of the visible light, we can identify what is the metal present in the salt. So the experimental setup what I have shown here, so this experiment can also be performed in your household. What happened? I have shown here one Bunsen burner, and this experiment can be performed in gas stove also, LPG gas stove. And what we have done here, we have taken the salt containing metal. The metal is here, I have tested here, copper, sodium, and calcium. And this is the color actually shown in the flame test of this metal, the metal salt. So what happened? In the first case, I have taken copper sulfate solution. Copper sulfate, as I understood, if it is heated by taking in a glass rod directly to the oxidizing flame of this Bunsen burner, it gives very nice green coloration. So if the salt solution, salt sample gives green coloration on burning, that indicate that the salt solution contains copper ion. Similarly, if the salt is heated in a glass tube, not glass tube, glass rod, if it gives golden color, so this indicate that the salt is a sodium ion is present in the salt. That is the common salt. And even calcium carbonate, you can test the calcium carbonate. If the unknown salt, if it is calcium carbonate, if you not know, it is not known, then if you burn it in the oxidizing flame, then it will give very good big red color. So this indicates the presence of calcium in the salt. So this experiment I have done here like this. So in the glass rod, I have taken the copper sulfate solution and then I burned it, so it gives very nice green coloration. So this indicates the copper ion is present in the salt. Similarly, the second experiment, I have taken common salt, sodium chloride. So I take it in the glass rod and try to burn it, and it gives very golden flame. So this indicates sodium ion is present. Similarly, in this experiment, I have taken calcium carbonate, and burning it gives very big red flame. So this indicates that given sample contain calcium ion. So this experiment with care can be done in everybody's house. So taking this idea, so what happened in the flame test, we can assume, we can get some idea, then we can perform in the laboratory. Now I want to show the important topic of our discussion, that is remote triggered simulation for predicting or prediction of reaction mechanism. We want to study the reaction mechanism. Basically, in the undergraduate syllabus, there is SN1 reaction, SN2 reaction. So we want to study the mechanism. And in studying the mechanism, if you do the experiment in the laboratory, basically we are unable to see the structures of the compound. We only take the sample. But in the computational lab, what happened? We are doing the reaction in the molecular level. So we can understand, we can see the molecule, and we can rotate the molecule as per our wish. Then we can perform the experiment, and we can know where the nucleophile will attack, where the electrophile will attack. So what I have written here, that is quantum chemical calculation means basically the basic calculation, that is, as we understand the computational chemistry, that is, we are using computer to understand the properties of chemistry. That is called computational chemistry in the simple sentence. In the computational chemistry, what we are using quantum chemistry. So that is why I have mentioned here, quantum chemical calculation can be performed by adopting different software. Softwares are important because nowadays software-based, some softwares are there. So with the help of software, anybody can perform chemical experiment in the laboratory. Or in the, from there, and this experiment can be done from home by remote logging. So what are the software basically needed? Basically, we are using here Gaussian software, we are using Orca software, and DMOL 3 software. So what we are doing, so we are studying the most probable reaction mechanism by calculating Gibbs free energy. So all chemistry students or chemistry student knows what is Gibbs free energy, and by drawing the relative activation free energy profile diagram. So we'll be showing all these steps, how to do, how to study the reaction mechanism with the help of computer. Here I have shown here an HPC server. HPC means high performance computing server. That is this high power computer that is connected through internet. Anybody can perform the experiment. Even from a student from Jorhat Kendriya Mahavidyalaya, if he wish to perform any experiment at Assam University, he can do by connecting through HPC server installed in the Department of Chemistry, Assam University. So for this purpose, what basically it requires? It requires some connecting device. That is, it requires software, another software, this PuTTY and WinSCP. So with the help of these two software, you can connect the computer or the server installed at Assam University, so that you can perform the experiment from your home. So what we can do in the computational chemistry, first of all, we can know the structure of the compound. The first compound I have shown here is the methane. And in the laboratory, basically, the methane is not visible. You cannot see the structures of methane. Methane is a gas. But basically what happened, in methane, the carbon is connected to 4 hydrogen, and you can understand the bond length, all the bond angle here. I have shown here, the carbon-hydrogen bond length is 1.09 angstrom. And similarly, the bond angle is around 4.7 degrees. So second molecule is ethanol. So the motto of showing this slide is that with the help of computational chemistry, we can visualize the molecule, three-dimensional structure. We can visualize the three-dimensional structure of the molecule. Then we can understand the bond length. We can understand the conformation. Then we can understand the electrophilic site. We can understand the nucleophilic site. Then we can perform the experiment. So this very example is included in the undergraduate syllabus of chemistry. So here I have shown the reaction of SN1 reaction, where what happened, a tertiary butyl bromide is treated with sodium hydroxide, and we obtain the alcohol, where one part of the alcohol what is formed is with the retention of the configuration, and other part with the inversion of the configuration. That is, we will be getting the racemic mixture. So this experiment, this very experiment, simply we can do in the laboratory, and we can show to the students also. For doing this experiment, what we need to do, we need to get some software to draw the three-dimensional structure of the molecule. And for drawing the three-dimensional structure, basically the softwares are available nowadays. One is GaussView, ChemCraft, and Avogadro, and some other, ChemDRAW is also there. And these softwares are not free, basically. The ChemCraft was free. Avogadro nowadays free, everybody can use, but others are not free. Similarly, for performing the experiment, we require some input. That is, with the structure, we have to build one input to run in the computer. That input, basically, you can manually you can prepare, but nowadays, with the help of software, anybody can create the input. Initially, when I performed my PhD, I used to create the input manually. But nowadays, softwares are available. So GaussView, ChemCraft, or Avogadro, using this software, we can create the input, and that input can be run in the high-performance computing server, where the calculation, where you can get the actual structures of the molecule. So, how to run it? As per the requirement of proper command is necessary, as because our server basically it works in Linux environment. So it is command-based, actually work with the command. So we should understand or know some command to start the simulation. And this command basically is transmitted through PuTTY, because if you directly attach with the computer, directly you can go to the computer. But a person from other place, that's from Jorhat, if you want to perform the experiment, he has to connect the server through PuTTY. So this is some technical terms, not necessary. Anybody who is interested can be done very easily, no problem, very simple thing. So what happened here, I have shown the structure. These structures are generated through computational calculation. This is the reactant. I have taken tertiary butyl bromide. And in the first step, there will be ionization, and it will form this intermediate, the carbocation. It will be stabilized by some inducting effect of methyl group. Then what will happen, it will give these two products. One is the retention of configuration, other product is the inversion of the configuration. What happened here? So I have shown here, this is the carbocation. This carbocation is shown here, the 3D orbital picture. This orbital picture shows, this is the, as most of we know, actually the for reacting two species, what happened? HOMO of one species interacted with the LOMO of the other species. What happened here? In the intermediate carbocation, it has one vacant pure P orbital. That is vacant p orbital that it can accommodate electrons. So it is called LUMO, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. And this hydroxyl ion, it's fully filled orbital, that is called HOMO, highest occupied molecular orbital. And these two orbital, the same symmetric orbital, that is, these two lobes showing the symmetry, the same symmetric overlapping will create the formation of the molecule. So if it attacks from above, then this lobe will interact with the HOMO of this. Similarly, if it attack from backside, so that is two product is possible, then the green color lobe will interact with the green color. So same symmetric overlapping is allowed. So I have performed the experiment, and I have shown the transition state here. I have created the transition state. This transition state can be evaluated through computational study. So what happened here? When the bromide ion going away, then the carbon is interacted with the O of the hydroxyl ion. So this is the transition state we are showing here. So this transition state can be generated with the help of computational chemistry. So this is another experiment, the energy profile I have shown here. What happened? This is SN2 mechanism. So here I have taken a methyl bromide, and the product in this case is methanol. with the inversion of the configuration. Why inversion? Because the bromide ion is on the right hand side, so hydroxyl ion will approach this carbon atom from left hand side. So what happened in this reaction? Basically, the antibonding orbital of carbon bromine bond, the lobe of the antibonding orbital is backside of the bromine. That is, you can say the backside far from the PR, that is, this side will contain the left hand side of this carbon will contain the antibonding lobe of the carbon BR bond. So what will happen? The hydroxyl ion will approach from backside. So that is why it will form this compound with complete inversion of the configuration. So in this case, what happened here? So you can see the transition is stopped. So the carbon bond between bromine and carbon is breaking, then it will form a bond between carbon and hydroxyl ion. So this is the three-dimensional structure is shown to illustrate the reaction mechanism. So here I have shown the tautomerization, keto enol tautomerization reaction. Very simple reaction you can perform. So you can see the variation of energy. So what happened here, the hydrogen from this carbon is detached itself and attaching to the oxygen, and likewise the double bond of carbon double bond is changing to carbon. So this is simple experiment of tautomerization. This can be shown to the undergraduate student during the class also. So this experiment can be performed very easily. With a very short period of time, you can perform this experiment. And very important, interesting point is that to performing this computational chemistry research or to do experiment, the lab work with computational chemistry, it requires more time in comparison to experiment to carry out the reactions. But that time will depend upon the power of the computer. So nowadays, high power computer is available, so we can perform the experiment with a short span of time. So now I will show some light demonstration how this experiment can be performed. Is my desktop is visible, Vinod?
Yes, sir.
So can you see the desktop, my desktop?
No, it's PowerPoint only. PowerPoint only.
Okay, then I will have to share the desktop. Okay, what? How to share it is a big problem. Is it visible now?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So now I will show the live demonstration how to perform the reaction. So simple example, first of all, I will show then. So for this purpose, we'll take two software. One is GaussView. Here you can see GaussView 6.0 and another software is Gaussian 09. Is it visible, Vinod?
Yes.
Okay. So, with the help of this software, what we can do, we can draw the structure. The structure may not be correct structure, so the rough structure we'll have to draw. And that from this rough structure, we'll have to perform the quantum chemical calculation to obtain the correct structure. So, what we have to do, the simple thing I want to show here, as we know, the hydrogen in water molecule, H bond length is around 104 degree, isn't it? Everybody, we know, all chemists know that bond length of water is 104 degree. Similarly, if we change the oxygen with sulfur, the bond length again will increase or decrease, we'll have to monitor. So that experiment I will show here first. So first of all, we draw water molecule. this software. This is called GauzView. So first we can create this water molecule. So in this water molecule, you can give any bond, any type of or any measure of the bond angle. So what happened? What is the bond angle? Just let me see here. Their bond angle is, you can see 109 degree. Basically, we know bond angle of this carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and hydrogen is around 104 degree. But I have given here the bond angle is 109 degree. Then we'll try to perform the experiment. Then we see the bond angle is very, this correct bond angle is different. So how to do it? We have to create an input. The input can also be created with GauzView. Here, what we have to do? We have to do optimization. That is, we want to get the ground state energy. For doing this purpose, actually, it requires some basic knowledge on the quantum chemistry. So we want to perform density functional theory calculation. Then we'll have to take the basis set. So basis set is very important. Basis set basically is, you can understand simply that you can assume now that basis set represents the correct orbital of the atom or as a molecule. So what will happen? Then we'll have to give the name. Let name of the molecule is water. So then we'll have to save this. So we'll have to save this one. So for doing this, so it will create an input. It will create an input water molecule. After completion of the input, then we can open the input. Here I have kept some input here. So here I have kept the input of water molecule here. So I'm showing once again here. This is the input of water molecule. Now we'll perform the calculation. Same thing what I have just shown here. Edit, then we'll have to edit it. So this is the input I have created. Basically, initially, before this GauzView came into existence, what we have to do, we used to create this input manually. What happened here, that this first number, it represents the X coordinate of hydrogen, first hydrogen, this is Y coordinate, this is Z coordinate. Similarly, for second hydrogen, this is X coordinate, this is Y coordinate, this is Z coordinate. Similarly, for oxygen, this is first is X coordinate, Y coordinate, and Z coordinate. That's the three-dimensional location of the atoms of the molecule. And this shows the connectivity. One is connected to three, two is connected to the three. So this is the connectivity of them. So this is nothing only. So now what happened? We'll have to run this. When we run this calculation, it will go to the Gaussian software. So this is Gaussian software. So here it will run. It will take little time. Water molecule is very simple molecule. It will not take so much of time. So little time will be taken. But if whenever you go to the correct laboratory and you perform some unknown experiment, if the system is very large, then it can take 3-4 days for optimization of a simple one. So I am showing only water molecule. So this experiment can be shown in any college with the help of a simple software. Softwares are nowadays not very costly. And the teaching will also become very interesting. So what happened? The calculation Gaussian job has completed. So now we can see the actual structure here. So initially I have taken the water molecule where the carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, hydrogen bond angle was 109 degree. And this is the structure we obtain after optimization. And here, the bond angle we can see here, this is bond angle 1, 3. And this bond angle is coming around 104 degree, 0.467. It's nothing, no, did not worry. So you can say 104 degree. So therefore, we can assume that water molecule, hydrogen, oxygen, hydrogen bond angle is 104. So now we like to just little modify it. We replace this hydrogen, oxygen with sulfur, then also try to know the bondable. So the structure what we have taken here, they are also bondable. We have taken 190 degree. Now we'll perform the same calculation. Therefrom we'll try to find out the correct bond angle. So this is the input. Once again, similar input is created. Here only oxygen is substituted by sulfur. So it will taking time. So it will be taking little more time in comparison to water, because the calculation time depend upon the number of electron. As we have substituted oxygen with sulfur, number of electron will be little more. So it will take more time for completion of the calculation. So after completion of this calculation, we can see the bond angle. We have given the bond angle at 109 degree. Now in this case, rough structure we have given 109 degree. Now we try to find out what is the bond angle here. So now bond angle become 92.65. that is, with substitution of oxygen by sulfur, that hydrogen sulfide is an angular molecule, its bond angle is 92. So is it understandable, Vinod?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this way we can perform many experiments. So now a question comes: can only we know only the bond length, bond angle, or the structure? No, we can do everything what we obtain in experimental science. So we can perform, we can simulate the IR spectra, NMR spectra, Raman spectra, transition state, everything can be evaluated through this computational technique. So now I will try to show the IR spectra of the molecule. So for calculation of IR spectra, basically it requires a little more time. So but if consuming time in this light demonstration, it will be boring. So anyway, I am showing here. So the process of calculation is very similar. So this is the compound I have taken. This is nitrophenol. This is one compound, nitrophenol. Here this nitro group and this OH group here attached with benzene. So this is nitrophenol. So similar calculation we can perform here. Now what we will do in this case, for calculation of IR spectra, only what we have to do, we will have to calculate frequency. That is, optimization we'll have to do. In addition to the optimization, we'll have to calculate frequency. If we calculate frequency, then we will get the output file of this type. It will take more than 15 minutes for calculation in the, this system. So this is the compound we will get. So here from, we will try to find out the vibrational spectra, how the molecules are vibrating. We can see. You can see the vibration of this OH bond or nitrogen oxygen bond. So we try to animate it. So IR stretching frequency of this OH bond, you can see OH bond is vibrating here only, OH bond. It's coming around 3817.03 centimeter inverse. So IR spectra, you can see like this. So similarly, you can calculate the IR spectra of other molecules also. So now we can see the vibration, how it is vibrating. So we can see all the vibrations are available. Any vibration we can select, we can get that particular vibration. So after, then basically we, in computational chemistry, you can show how the molecules are vibrating. Basically, in the experimental science, we get the IR spectra. So this is the IR spectra of this molecule. So this is generated in this computer. This is IR spectra. This is the band. If you click anywhere, you will get the value here. So just now I have shown the OH spectra, OH vibrational spectra. This is coming around 3800 17.0 centimeter hertz. This is OS testing frequency. Similarly, these are the frequency. This is coming around 1393.3 centimeter inverse. This is actually carbon-carbon double bond of aromatic ring. So this is the IR spectra. That is, not only we can understand the structure, we can also understand the IR spectra also. That is, we can generate the IR spectra, we can generate the UV spectra, we can generate the NMR spectra of the molecule. So up to this point, is anything to be shared? Vinod, is all right?
Yes, sir.
So, likewise, we can do many things. We can, now I will show the transition state, how the transition state can be generated. So, but this type of calculation require a huge time. So I have already calculated something, so I will be showing here only. So I have taken the structure here, the structures of the input. So this is the structure I have taken input. That input means this is not input, this is output. This is methanol. How to synthesize methanol? We want to treat methyl bromide with sodium hydroxide. So then what we'll have to do, we'll have to take one input for transition state. So this is the input, a tentative structure must be given to the input to calculate the actual structure. So this is the tentative structure I have created, that transition state will be like this, similar to this. But this bond angle is randomly I have given, it's not the correct bond length. So I have given this bromine carbon bond length is 2.7 angstrom. Similarly, the carbon oxygen bond length I have given 2.06. And this is the random structure I have given. So, first of all, to performing this experiment, you should have a little idea of the structure, how the transition structure will be looking like. Thus, you can assume it may not be correct. Sometimes it may be wrong, but you'll have to assume it. Then we'll create the input to calculate the transition state. For calculating transition state here, we'll have to doing binary calculation here. So that is why we have given here TS binary. That's TS means transition state. Then we'll have to calculate this. We'll have to make this input. That is, we want to get the transition state. Then we'll have to edit it. That is, edit means this, we have to save this structure as an input file. So we'll be getting this input file. This is the input file just now I have shown here. This is the input file where these are the coordinate, X, Y, Z coordinate of all the atom present in the body. All the atom present in the body. After getting the X, Y, Z coordinate of the molecule, then we'll have to run this calculation in the Gaussian software. So what we'll have to do? We are using the GaussView interface directly. We can go to calculation. Once again, we edit here. But it will take a longer, very long time, more than 2 hours to complete this calculation. So I am not showing here. So I am showing the output file here. So output file I have generated here. So this is the output file, R2TS. This is generated here. So this is the transition structures of the transition state. This is the structure of the transition state. Now you can verify what is the bond length I have given, and this bond length is different. I have given it is 2.3, now it becomes 2.28. Approximately I have given, you can increase or decrease also, no problem. And similarly, this side also, this bond length is 1.9, I have given 2.2. So after this, now I want to find out whether, how this atom will move, that is, this Br is detaching from carbon and OH is attaching to the carbon. This transition state, we can visualize. How can we can visualize here? Just we can see the result. We want to show the vibration here. Now we can animate. So how the, in the transition state, how the molecule will vibrate with respect to this two atom. Once this carbon will connect itself to hydroxyl ion, or it will connect to Br. So it is initially connected with Br, now it's connected to OA. So this is the vibration of the transition field. That is, both A will vibrate. But this state is not very, this transition state is not very stable. It immediately either go to the left hand side or go to right hand side. Depending upon the energy, which substance will be more stable, it will move that way. So the transition state, that is why it's very unstable. For a moment of time, it will create it and immediately it will going, giving you the product. So this is the transition state. So once we know the transition state, then we understood the vibrational spectra. Similarly, we can know the IR spectra also. But this calculation taking a longer time, so that I'm showing here only the output spectrum file. This is the structure I have taken, this acetone. The acetone, basically, if you want to know the UV spectra, basically it important is N to pi star transition, and that transition is a forbidden transition, intensity will be very less. So that spectra you want to generate. So for generating expertise to handling this software, it will take little time. Only 1 month is sufficient to understand this basic experiment. 1 month is sufficient to understand. So this is the IR spectra of this one. Not IR, the UV spectra. IR, this is the UV spectra. And you see, this intensity of this spectra is very high, and others is very low. Others means these are forbidden transition. That's the N to pi star transition. This transition is very important. It's coming around 340 nanometer. This N to pi star transition of acetone is coming around 340. So, and another point is that accuracy of or calculation basically will depend upon what type of basis set we are using. If you are using very simple basis set, then our accuracy will be a little bit less. So that is why, so little knowledge on the quantum chemistry will make you more suitable to perform this spectacle in the laboratory and to predict the correct reaction mechanisms. So we can, with the help of this computational tool, we can study many things as per our wish. If we want to study the reaction mechanism, we can do. We can, if you want to find out the electrophilic site, nucleophilic site, you can find out easily. So that is why we can perform that. What we are doing in our laboratory, we are studying the reaction mechanism, how the nucleophile will react with the molecule, how electrophile will react with the molecule or the substrate. So that part we are studying in our laboratory. So that part showing will be difficult because it will taking basically the calculation. The unknown system, if the system is having more than 100 atoms, if you are assuming, it will require the optimization, it will require not less than 5 to 6 days in the normal HPC computer. If you perform in the PC, the simple PC available in your house, it will take more than 1 month for optimization of a molecule having more than 100 atoms. So that is why these calculations are basically time-consuming. So with respect to this, another type of calculations are there. Therefore, you can assume something that is probably Pankaj Suti have discussed about the bioinformatics. In bioinformatics, what happened? Basic difference between bioinformatics and this computational chemistry, what we are discussing here is that in bioinformatics, basically we are using molecular mechanics. Molecular mechanics basically is applicable for the bulky system, larger system, but it is not applicable to the system containing electron, neutron, proton. So what happened? If you are assuming the molecule is a very bulky, very high mass, and if you want to apply Newtonian law of motion, then you can perform the calculation very easily. That is, optimization of this type of molecule requires less than 1 second, because you are using, in bioinformatics, they are using molecular mechanics. But what we are doing in our calculation, we are using quantum chemistry. So what happened? Quantum chemistry, basically we are dealing with the electron. Now we are applying Schrodinger's equation to solve the molecule. So Schrodinger equation, solving the Schrodinger equation once again, is very difficult for a system having more than one electron. That is, till now, we can solve a system having only one electron. That is, Schrodinger, solution of Schrodinger equation is, till now, is possible for a hydrogen atom only, till now. But we are studying very large system having hundreds of electrons, then how it is possible. Just now I have mentioned that solution of Schrodinger equation is only possible till now with a system having only one electron, but we are taking a system, very bulky system, having hundreds of electrons, then solution should not be possible. But how we are solving? We are solving taking some approximation. And the simple approximation, the most simple approximation is the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. This is the first approximation is taken to solve the Schrodinger equation. But in bioinformatics, basically, they are using the Newtonian law. And that is why their calculation become very simple. But in that case, the chemist people basically will not be interested with that, because in that calculation, basically, you cannot find out the electrophilic center, the nucleophilic center, because we are assuming the molecule as a point mass in the bioinformatics. In the bioinformatics, what we are consuming, we are assuming the atoms are the point mass, electron, neutron, proton together point mass. But their distribution is not being considered. But in quantum chemistry, what we are doing, we are considering the electron. So then we are considering the electron, how electrons are distributed in the system. Then we can find out the electrophilic center, nucleophilic center. Likewise, we can find out the reactivity, how the reaction can be. And likewise, we are actually studying in our laboratory the reaction mechanism and predict the reaction mechanism of some unknown substance. Should I show some more experiment? Because it will be boring, probably. Because
No, sir, you can.
So we can show the, actually, basically what happened, we are taking some tentative structure. Tentative structure, that another molecule, I am showing another experiment. It will be very boring, I am showing this type of experiment, because it will taking time. So I am showing how to draw the structure. So now I want to draw the structure of benzene. So I am showing here how to draw it. So for benzene contain carbon atom. So basically contain this type of carbon. So easy to understand, you can take this type of, this carbon and hydrogen. Then we'll have to add carbon here. You can take simple carbon also, you can take, no problem. This carbon. Then you can convert it to carbon. It will be converted to carbon. So likewise, you can increase the structure. So simple. So therefrom, you can attach something else. Okay. So I'm simply going to, first of all, like to draw a simple molecule, then it will be easy to understand. This is the ethene molecule I have taken, ethene. It contains carbon, carbon, double bond. So there should be carbon, carbon, double bond. So you can make it fast. So you'll have to make like this. This is the carbon, carbon, single bond. This is ethane molecule. This is ethane. And from ethane, you can change the atom. Or add the atom like this. So what type of atom you want, you can add like this. If you can transfer it, make it carbon, then you can add hydrogen here. Then you can make this is carbon. So likewise, so it will a little tedious to form the draw the structure. So once you get the expertise, then you can easily draw the structure. So now we'll have to add the hydrogen here. Hydrogen, there are two hydrogen. Then you can add another hydrogen here. So you will have to make this is carbon, hydrogen. Once again, you have to make this carbon. So how many carbon I have given here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So another carbon will have to add. So now we'll have to add hydrogen here. So likewise, we'll have to do this one. So this become actually, I wanted to draw benzene, but what happened here, just look at here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I wanted to draw benzene, but I accidentally draw it, not the simple pentane. So now I'll have to make it benzene. So once again, little modification must be done. So you'll have to make another, add some another carbon to make this hydrogen carbon. Now it becomes 6. Now add these two carbon together. Little modification you do, and then you'll have to add hydrogen here. So now it becomes cyclohexane. This is neither board nor chair. So that's the cyclohexane I have created. So now I want to make it benzene. So benzene, what happened? All the carbon atom contain one hydrogen piece, but in all this carbon contain two hydrogen. So you have to first alternate double bond must be given. So now what happened? I have to delete one hydrogen from each carbon atom. So this is the raw structure of benzene. Then we'll have to make, as we understand, benzene is a planar molecule. If it's planar, then the structure of benzene will be like this. So one hydrogen is extra here. So tentative structure of the benzene will be like this. It contains alternate double bond, so this will be the tentative structure. Okay, so now I want to show another example. So another example, just in our pericyclic chemistry, we have drawn the orbital structures of butadiene. So there, what we have done, we have made psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, and psi 4. Four orbital structure has been represented in our book, and what it is presented, that in the psi 1 there is no node in the orbital, and psi 2 there is one node, psi 3 there is two node, and psi 4 there is three node. So that experiment I will show how the orbital structure varies with the energy level. So for that purpose, just I will have to draw the butadiene. So this is the simple structure of butadiene. Already understood, all the carbon atom are sp2 hybridized. The molecule should be planar. It's very much planar, simple. Now what we'll have to do, we'll have to calculate, optimize it to know the orbital structure. So we want to optimize it. So for optimization, we'll have to do optimization OPT means optimization plus frequency. That is, I am to get higher spectrals together. And I have used some basis set is 631Z. Nowadays, in the PG level, this basis set is taught. So basis set is important. Basis set is nothing but, don't be confused. So it is simple, you can say, the orbital. How the electrons in the atoms are present, that is represented by orbital, for simple understanding. So now I will have to calculate this. For calculation, we want to get population, that is how electrons are distributed in the orbital. That is why we are writing population regular. Then we'll have to save it. So I'm saving it beta time. Then we'll have to run it. So first of all, this is the input. Already I have mentioned that we need only the XYZ coordinate, nothing else. We want for three-dimensional structure what we have drawn, but in Gaussian calculation, three-dimensional structure is not necessary. Only XYZ coordinate of all the atoms are necessary. So we got the XYZ coordinate, then we'll run the calculation. Yes, I want to run the. So it will return. After completion of the calculation, we can see how the orbitals of beta time looks like. So it will be taking time because there are because our calculation times depend upon the number of electrons. So it will be complete. It's not taking so much time. So completing shortly. So completion calculation is completed. So now I want to get the optimized structure. What I got, this is optimized structure butadiene. So therefore, I want to see whether it is possible or not to get the orbital structure of butadiene. Little mistake I have done. So once again I see it. So look at here, I will be showing the orbital structure here. So basically in our book, what we are showing only four orbitals. Basically for butadiene, as many as, how many orbitals are created? 48 orbitals are possible. Out of these 48 orbitals, most of the orbitals are empty. You can see these are antibonding orbitals. The right hand side, alpha MO means it's an antibonding orbital. These antibonding orbitals, you see, these are antibonding orbitals. And from here, orbital number 16 and 15, you can look at here, the 15 is the last orbital, which is completely filled. This is called HOMO, highest occupied molecular orbital. And it started from 1. So all other orbitals are filled up. It may be sigma electron or pi electron, whatever it may be. We are concentrated to the orbit, the valence orbital. So this orbital, you can see, this orbital is called HOMO. And above this, this is called LUMO. lowest unoccupied orbital. This orbital having no electron, that is why this is the high energy orbital, low energy orbital among the empty orbital. This is the low energy orbital, that is why it's the lowest unoccupied. There is no electron. So the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, this is highest occupied molecular orbital. So in our poo, only showing four orbital, one orbital, two bonding orbital and two anti-bonding orbital. And these four electron basically are the four pi electron presence in butadiene. So that is why we are showing only this four orbital in our poo. What is the structure of this four orbital? This four orbital connected with only pi electron. So we'll try to find out how they are looking like, how these orbitals are looking like. So we'll have to want to visualize it. Only this four orbital, orbital number 14, orbital number 15, orbital number 16, orbital number 17. 14 is nothing but only psi 1, 15 psi 2, 16 psi 3, and 17 is psi 4. What we have studied during studying pericyclic chemistry. So we'll have to update it. On updating, orbital structure will be generated. It will be like taking time. So now look at here. We come to the structures of psi 1. In psi 1, already understood there is no node. Is it visible, sir? So there is no node in this molecule. Vinod, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
So now what happened? This is psi 1. So now I want to, so this is the symmetry. The color represents the symmetry, upper part and lower part. So in our books, basically we are showing the dumbbell shape, p orbital type. Above we are writing positive and below we are writing negative. That is nothing but the symmetry. The symmetry is different. Above symmetry of top part is different, symmetry of lower part is different. So symmetry I'm not discussing here. The simple symmetry. This is psi 1. There is no node among the inside the orbital. Now coming to psi 2. In psi 2, this is the orbital here. That is overlapping of this p orbital of nearby two carbon atoms. So there are four carbon atoms now showing two carbon atoms. That is, this first and second carbon atom, there is overlapping. Third and fourth carbon, there is overlapping. So this is, there is only one node. Similarly, if we go to psi 3, then it will become two nodes. So this is two nodes. Only this is pure p orbital type, first and third, and second is the orbital overlapping between carbon number second and carbon number third. So this is the orbital division. So now come to psi 3. So this is psi 4. So here happen, what happened? There are three nodes. That's first one. This is pure p orbital, this is another pure p orbital. So there is no overlapping. So basically what happened, in the antibonding state, there is less possibility of overlapping. And that is why electrons are not accommodated in the antibonding orbital. So if electrons are accommodated in the antibonding orbital, such molecule will be unstable. So in the butadiene, what I have shown here, so this is the orbital representation, what we have studied in pericyclic chemistry. So these are the orbital structures of butadiene. Similarly, other orbital structures, because of benzene also, we can generate. So I am not generating so much structure because it is taking time. So wait time is a little boring. So I don't want to show it. So if any one of you is interested, then you can contact me so that I can show the more calculation in near future. So in this demonstration actually showing, because this participant basically belongs from chemistry, physics, biological sciences. So it will not be very much interesting for them also. So keeping that point on time, point in mind, so I like to conclude from here. These are the structures already I have discussed. So this is actually the wanted to show. I wanted how to draw the structure, how to run it in Gaussian 03, and I have shown the transition, how to generate the transition state. Then I have shown the orbital structure. So this mass is sufficient for today's discussion, sir. Thank you, sir.
Wow.
Thank you, sir, for your illuminating and thought-provoking delivers
another thing I'd like to mention here. Thank you, Madam, for giving me the opportunity to share our idea among this August gathering belonging of teaching community and the students. I thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now, if any participants have any queries, please ask Professor Poritus Mandal, sir. If anybody have any questions, please ask Professor Mandal, sir. Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, madam, we are audible. Actually, this topics one I have discussed is more, basically, most of things are very complicated, very new, I can say.
Yeah.
Very few people are involved in this type of calculation nowadays. So, the rate is increasing, so more people will be involved in this type of calculation near future. So,
yes, sir, it is a very interesting one, sir, for us also.
Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome, sir. Okay, anybody is there? Any questions? Otherwise, we'll go to the next step. Okay, Binod?
Yes, yes. Yes, yes.
We'll go to the next step.
Yes.
Hope all the participants were able to gather knowledge, useful knowledge, information from Dr. Professor Mandal sir's presentation. Professor Mandal sir's presentation, in his presentation, has shown how, with the help of computer software and molecular modeling, one can study the reaction mechanism such as SN1, SN2, etc. His presentation will help all the participants, more specifically with the background of chemistry. He has also shown how one can carry out certain practicals like acid-based titration, film test, detection of metal ions at home. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We are looking forward, sir, for your future involvement with our institute, with our college, our department.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll be happy to involve activities of the of your college. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir, once again. Next, Binod.
Yes, Sinki.
Sinki is there, Dr. Sinki Kolita. Are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, Dr. Sinki Kolita will demonstrate on some household chemistry practicals. She has completed her PhD from NIST, formerly RRL. Currently, she is working as an assistant professor in the Department of Chemistry of Jorhat Kendriya Mahavidyalaya. Dr. Sinki Kolita, you may proceed now. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, Sinki, go ahead.
Okay. Yes, Sinki, carry on.
Respected principal sir, respected HODM, respected honorable guest, Professor Poritus Mandal sir, all respected members present here, students and friends. Today, I am going to present you a topic, application of Boswell lab for synthetic chemistry. Actually, I am very new in this field and I have very, very little knowledge about it. But anyway, I don't want to say it's a lecture to give you knowledge about this field. I'm just trying to share you some things that I have learned about it. So First of all, I would like to thank Professor Boritus Mondal sir for giving a very nice and interesting presentation, and for showing us this different apps for executing this type of reactions and this type of applications in the organic chemistry, and we will try to execute all these things in our college. Thank you, sir. Now, I am going to my topic, actually, application of virtual lab for synthetic chemistry. As you all aware now, from first day onwards of this workshop, all the honorable members, they have given lot of information about virtual labs. And actually, the virtual lab are considered as one of the most important applications of e-learning in educational and research institutions. They provide students with the opportunity to control experiments without exposure, any risk, and without human supervision by using computer applications in different fields of science. Modern teaching methods are varied. And one of these methods is the simulation method, which is used by the virtual lab. Also, simulation is one of the most important teaching and training methods that help to reduce cost of the education process. It saves time and efforts as well. And though simulation, students are able to develop many personal skills, which is one of the educational goals. Far about to give you knowledge about virtual lab, as you are aware of this one. So I would like to show you today one of the application in OLAB actually. Here, my screen is visible.
Yes, yes, it's visible.
Okay. Here you see, you have to search OLAB and then go to this website and click on this chemistry part. Now you can see there are a lot of experiments here. It is given as class 12 experiments, but in our courses there this experiments are doing in our TDC actually BSc level, undergraduate level. So I want to show you this application of synthetic chemistry. This is the paper chromatography part. Actually, this synthetic chemistry applications are lots of there. That is qualitative analysis, quantitative analysis, spectroscopic part, and a lot of the applications in synthetic organic chemistry. But I will show you a simple and very easy method for easy method of application. This is paper chromatography. Now you see, you can see, this is, there is a theory about paper chromatography. In this theory, you can see what is chromatography. Actually, this chromatography, the word is chroma and graphene. These two words combine and give the chromatography word. The meaning of this word is it is color writing actually. Now, in the chromatography technique, the mixture of substances allowed onto a phase called a stationary phase. Actually, what happened? Organic compounds are not pure. They may be obtained from natural source or other sources, or synthetically prepared organic compounds are not actually pure. So various methods are used for the purification of organic compound. This is chromatography is one such type of purification method. First of all, chromatography techniques, the mixture substance is applied onto a phase called the stationary phase and another phase that is called the mobile phase. That is the moving phase that can be pure solvent or a mixture of solvent or a gas is allowed to move slowly over the stationary phase. This moving phase is, I am already told you, this is the mobile phase. A lot of classification of chromatography better adsorption chromatography. This is column chromatography and thin layer chromatography are the subdivisions. And I'm not going to this thin layer or column chromatography. I will go to this paper chromatography. In paper chromatography, the stationary phase is this special quality paper called chromatography paper. Mobile phase is a solvent or a mixture of solvent. A solution of the mixture is spotted on a line about 2 cm above the bottom of the paper called original line or baseline. And suspended in a chromatographic chamber containing suitable solvent. We will prepare the solvent and we will run that chromatography. The solvent rises up the paper by a capillary action and flows over the spot. The paper selectively retains different components according to their different partitions in 2 phases. This paper strip so developed is called chromatogram. Okay, and how we will calculate this? We will calculate this with the help of RF value. What is RF? RF is the value, it is a ratio actually. It is the distance traveled by the component from the original line divided by the distance traveled by the solvent from the original line. There are 2 types of paper chromatography. One is ascending paper chromatography, another is descending paper chromatography. In ascending paper chromatography, the solvent is below and it is going up upward direction, and in the descending paper chromatography, the solvent is coming from the upside direction. So now I am going to the procedure part. Here you see, there is a theory, there is a procedure part, there is an animation simulator, and all these things are there. You have to click the procedure. You see, we need a lot of things. Actually, we need this chromatography chamber, measuring jar, Whatman filter paper. It is a type of filter paper which we are using in paper chromatography. Here we are using solvent as isopropyl alcohol and distilled water we are using. Why we are using, I will tell you later. Now, we are using the feature of pencil and scale. Okay. Now, what we will do? Now, I am going to the simulator part. What you can do in this website? Here, all things. First of all, you have to select. This. Okay, you have to select this mixture. What mixture we are using for running of this chromatography? You have to select this picture. Now here it is already there. This is red plus blueing. Okay. Now select a solvent. We need a solvent for running this chromatography. For that, we are using isopropyl alcohol and water. We are using polar solvent. Actually, there is lot of theory. Here, it is very little one. Actually, for stationary phase and while there's a lot of story, you have to go through your books for getting more knowledge about chromatography and about the running of the solvent, running of the mobile phase, and about the solvent system. What we are using, why you are using, you have to go through your book. Now, there are a lot of systems, polar solvent, non-polar solvent, mixture of polar or non-polar solvent, why we can use. And for this pot, we have to use this polar solvent because content, what we are using, should be dissolved in that solvent. So if it is not dissolved in water, we have to use some organic solvent for dissolving that component. Okay, now going to the simulator part, you see, first, we will use this capillary, and we can take here from we are taking. Sorry. We have to do this. Sorry, just stop working. Okay, now it is coming. We have to dip here this capillary and we can give a spot here. This line, you see, before giving this spot, we have to draw a line minimum 4 centimeters above the bottom of this paper. And another line here is a straight line, you see. Here we can make a point here, P. Okay. And then to give the spot here. And here you see the chamber. This chamber is called chromatographic chamber, where we are using the solvent. Where it is isopropyl alcohol and water is already there. We can make this in our laboratory, but now we are doing it online. So here it is already there. Isopropyl alcohol and water already there. So what we will do? We will keep this to this chamber. First of all, we have to open this. Now we are opening one and we have to just keep this here. It will not start before we are not this we are not just we have to block this like this. After that it will start. Why we are not why it is not running? Because we have to keep this chamber isolated, otherwise some problems will come. We have to close this chamber. Here you can see there are two spots. For one is for blue and other is for red. Now we can take it out here. You see here two spots are coming. Can you see this? Okay. Now you see you have to mark this solvent front. This is the solvent front. Solvent is running up to here, so you have to measure the solvent front, the distance from this point P to the to this level. Okay, and mark here in the middle of that point. Now I am clicking on this. On here you show this is a source scale. You see here you see that there is a scale. You can see the solvent is running up to this level. This is 5 centimeters. Distance traveled by the solvent is 5 centimeters. Okay, here it is, right, it is there. If I will write here 4, it will show this wrong answer. Why? Because it is 5 centimeters here. You see, here it is 5 centimeters. So I am giving here this 5 centimeters. Now see, here is the point, blue point. You see this distance traveled by the blue ink. It is how much? 4.9. Here I am giving 4.9. You see here, it is right. Then you see here red ink is there, so it is 4.4, I think. So I am given here 4.4. You can calculate the value of RF. How you can calculate? You have to divide this. How? This is 4.9 divided by 5. Actually, the RF value is what? It is a ratio. It is a ratio distance traveled by the solvent divided distance traveled by the component divided by distance traveled by the solvent. So here distance traveled by the blue ink is 4.9 divided by distance traveled by the solvent, that is 5. So we will get something like this. Okay, here you will get one to help that you can click this help button and you will get the all information about it. There you see chromatography is the technique for separation of those solutes in the same solvent. So I have shown you this chromatography part. If you want, then again I will show you the simulator part. What I have done, first of all we have taken ink from here and from capillary. With the help of capillary we are taking ink, and here we are giving a spot. You see here we are giving a spot. Now what we will do, we will give this Whatman filter paper to this chromatographic chamber where the solvent is already there. We have to open this chamber. Then we have to keep this what paper here. Then we have to close this for any disturbance, ignoring any disturbance. So we have to stop this, and it will take some time. Then you see the spot is running upward, as the solvent is running upward, the spot is also running upward. So for this RF, it is a retention factor. Then you see you will get the chromatography, this paper chromatography. These are the spots. Then we will click on this show scale. Then we will get this distances. We have to measure this with a scale and we will get the answer. Here you will write the distance traveled by the solvent, distance traveled by the blue ink, distance traveled by the red ink. Then you will get the RF value. For this chromatographic part, we need this RF value. Okay? Now, these are all about the paper chromatography part. Now, I want to show you another experiment. I am going to the wall. Again, I am clicking here. And you see, there are a lot of experiments, but I am choosing this simple one I am choosing for you. Because we all are new about this, so I am choosing this one. For second, I will show you this preparation of organic compound. In our laboratory, in your BSc level, you have to practicate a lot of the compound. So I will show how in virtual lab we will compound. First of all, I am going to the theory part. What we will prepare? We will prepare first. I will show you this one, this sample of acetylene from aniline. Okay, now you see how we will prepare this. I'm not going through this, what is organic chemistry and all that. I will go directly to the synthesis of this acetylene. Here you see how we will prepare acetanilide. Acetanilide is prepared. You have to write this theory actually. So I am telling this. Acetanilide is prepared from aniline by acetylating it with acetic anhydride in the presence of glacial acetic acid. Aniline or phenylamine. The name of aniline is also phenylamine, is a primary amine with molecular formula C6H5NH2. It is basic in nature. How we will prepare? Acetic anhydride is an anhydride of acetic acid and acts as a source of SL group. Aniline acts with acetic anhydride by nucleophilic substitution reaction. The reaction between aniline and acetic anhydride is called acetylation. In this reaction, aniline acts as the nucleophile and acyl group from acetic anhydride acts as the electrophile. Here the hydrogen atom of aniline group is replaced by the acyl group. The chemical reaction is shown here. I am not going to the mechanism part and details of this one. I will just show you the simulation part and I will just show you the procedure how we will do this. Okay, now the procedure is that for the preparation of, I will show you in the simulator. Okay, for the preparation of this compound, we need aniline. About 10 ml of aniline we need. Acetic anhydride, we need acetic anhydride. Here, we have to select the select organic compound to be prepared. Here, lot of organic compounds list are there. Here, acetanilide, dibenzyl acetone, paranitroacetanilide, 2-nitrophenol aniline dime. We can prepare any one of these. What you have given in your syllabus, that according to that, we have to prepare these compounds. We have to take this acetanilide first. Then, Basal is conical plaques and RB plaques. RB plaques we need, filter paper we need, funnel we need, Bruchner funnel we need, water condenser, lot of things we need. The procedure is that how we will do. We have to take 10 ml of acetic anhydride. We need 10 ml of acetic anhydride. Here you see 10 ml acetic anhydride here in the round bottom flask. This is called round bottom flask. In laboratory, you can see that one. Here we need 10 ml of acetic anhydride in a dry 250 ml of RB flask. Round bottom flask is also called RB flask. And at 10 ml of glacial acetic acid, we have to add this glacial acetic acid and shake the content thoroughly. For this, what I will do, we will add this to this RB. Okay, here it is adding. What we will do then? We have to shake this one. Like this, we have to first shake this one. See, the shaking is going. And what we will do? To this mixture, we have to add 10 ml of aniline and feed to a condenser. Then here it is aniline. 10 ml aniline is already there in the measuring flask. Then we will add this aniline here. I am adding this aniline. And again, I will shake this one. Okay? See. Then go to the next part. Here you see the next. Then go to the next part. Here it is fitted with a condenser. You see it is fitted with a condenser. To know about better about condenser, you have to read your book. Okay. Then boil this mixture. We have to boil this mixture. And to boil this mixture, we have to put on this. Then what we will do in the next step, here you see, pour the liquid from the RB flask to 200 ml ice cold water. Here this is the liquid and here is the ice cold water. We have to pour this here. First of all, we have to keep this here and we cool it and then we will pour here. We will pour this. I'm pouring this one and I'm stirring with a glass rod. Here you see, this white precipitate come out. Here you see this white precipitate come out. Next, what we will do? This white precipitate we have to filter. How we will filter? This filter this white precipitate. How? We are using this Bruchner funnel. And we will add here this filter. I am filtering this one. For here, this filtration, we have to wash this one with water. Okay. Now we have filtered all this our precipitate and we washed with distilled water. Now we go to the next part. Next part is what? Now we have got the crude acetanilide. This is not actually pure. Now we have to go to the purification part. In this purification part, we are using recrystallization process. What we will do in recrystallization process? I am going to the recrystallization. Here we are crude precipitate of acetanilide. And what we will do? This take this crude precipitate of acetanilide in the beaker and add 50 ml of a mixture of 1 volume of acetic acid and 2 volume of water. Here it is 1 volume of acetic acid and 2 volume of water. There is a mixer. We have to add this. Here I am adding. Okay. Then I am keeping this one here. And we have to heat this. For heating, we have to turn this burner. Okay. It is dissolved. You see, it is dissolved. This hot solution, here it is hot solution. We have to cool it. Next, what we'll do? This hot solution of acetanilide, what we'll do? Filter out a crystal of acetanilide from and dry them by passing them between the fold of a filter paper and measure the weight of the crystal. Then we have to filter this. First of all, we have to cool this. sorry, I am using this help. Drag the beaker to the funnel for filter the solution. I am giving it here for filtering the solution. It is filtered. Then I am giving help. Then drag the conical flux to the ice bath to cool this content. I am keeping layer for cooling this content. Recrystallization is over. Now going to the next part. Here we have to again filter this crystal. How we will filter this crystal? First you see, we have to filter this. I am filtering this with the help of this Bruckner funnel, and I am taking out this. You see? I am transferring this crystal from here. I am transferring this crystal from here to here. I am taking out this crystal here. Here is the crystals of acetanilide. Next, you see, these are the crystals of acetanilide. I think you are not too much aware of this one. Again, I will show you this. First of all, what we have to do? First of all, we have to add acetic acid here. Here we have to this aniline. We have to shake it. Sorry. We have to shake it. Then we have to add this one here. Again, we have to shake it. Going to the next part, what we will do? We will heat this content by using a condenser. Next, what we will do? We will keeping this hot solution here for some time. And we pour here this solution here. We are pouring this one. And we will stir this. Here the, you see the strength. Next, what we will do? We have to filter this strength. Here. I am filtering this. Okay. Now recrystallization part. For the recrystallization, what we have to do? We have to add this acetic acid and water solution here. Then we have to heat it. For heating, we have to turn on this burner. Here you see it will be dissolved. Then going to the next part, what we will do? We will just filter this and keep this beaker in ice bath for cooling, for recrystallization. Next, we will filter this with the help of Bruckner funnel. And we are taking this acetanilide crystal. Next, you see, you will get the acetanilide and you can take the weight of this compound. Here is the crystal of acetanilide. Now, I want to show you under experiment. Here you can do anything. Here you can do dibenzyl acetone, peranitro acetanilide. In different website, you will get different preparations. You can try this. Now, I am going to my next experiment. Here, you see, in the next, I am going to the chemistry part, and I will show you here the test function. Here, I will show you the function. For the test, you have already done that test in your laboratory, actually. You see, the theory is that our objective is what? We have to test for unsaturation. We have to test for these groups, functional groups. It's alcoholic, phenolic, aldehyde, ketonic groups, carboxylic acid group, amino group. All these functional groups we have to test in our laboratory. But in B lab, in virtual lab, how we will do this in research lab. There is a theory about what? Organic chemistry theory about hydrocarbon. You can read this one, but I'm not going to this part. I will show you just these are some functional groups, alcohols, carboxylic acid, aldehydes, as you are aware of all these things. Now you see, here lot of tests are there. Test for unsaturation, what we will do? We will test bromine test, we can do Baer's test, and for alcoholic group, there are lot of tests, and we will do this in our simulator part. We will do in our simulator part, you see. First of all, what are the tests for this? You have to select. You have to select the test. Actually, I here you see. Test for unsaturation. There is a list of tests which you are aware, I think. And select the type. What you are doing, select the type. Here I am testing for unsaturation. When I will test for functional group, then it will come in different way. But I am now doing this unsaturation test. These are the preliminary tests in organic laboratory, what you have to do. Okay, now see, the test for functional groups. First, we have to select this type. What we are doing? We are doing this unsaturation. Okay, now, what we will do? We can do bromine water test and we can do Baer's test. First, I am doing this bromine water test. For this bromine water test, what is the procedure? How we will do this bromine water test? Procedure is that dissolve a little of the given organic compound. What organic compound you have to supplied organic compound you have to take in test. Then you have to test this bromine test. How you will do? Dissolve a little of the given organic compound in about 2 ml of distilled water. Here you see 2 ml of distilled water. I have dissolved this my supplied organic compound here into test tube and add a few drops of bromine water to it and shake well. I am just doing this saturated. This is saturated compound. This is unsaturated compound. Someone have given two compound. One is saturated. One is unsaturated. Then what I will do? I will take some bromine water and I will give here. Here the drops are here. And what we will do? I will shake this. I will shake this. It will happen. See, you can see here we will get this. Sorry, again, I am showing you this. This is the bromine water I am giving here. Okay, you can see this. There it is. I am shaking this. You see, I am shaking this test tube, but there is no change of color. You see, there is no change of color. No disappearance of orange red color of bromine. Then what is the result? Result is this saturated compound do not decolorize the red brown color of bromine water. You know about this one. So now I am going to the second part. Here it is unsaturated compound. I am giving here the drops of bromine water. Now I will shake this. You see the color will change or not? You see? Yes, the color is changing. What we will get? When bromine water reacts with unsaturated compound as alkene or alkyne, there is a reaction. Bromine water will react with alkene to produce dibromoalkenes and alkyne to produce tetrabromoalkenes. When a reaction occurs, molecule bromine, it consumes and its characteristic dark red brown color disappears. So disappearance of orange red color of bromine, then we will get the compound is unsaturated. This is unsaturated compound. If there is no disappearance of orange red color, then the compound is saturated. We finalize this. Now, what we will do? We will do this Baer's test. How we will do this Baer's test? Then this is a procedure is that we have to use alkaline KM4. Alkaline KM4. Procedure is that dissolve a little of the given organic compound in about 2 ml of distilled water. I am dissolving this in 2 ml of distilled water in a casket and few drops of alkaline solution. Alkaline, how we will prepare? We will add mechanized dioxide. Okay, for that it will be alkaline. Then alkaline solution of KM4 to it and shake it well. Here it is alkaline solution already prepared. So I am giving this here in test tube A. Here I am giving this. The color is pink color. And you see, is there any change? No, there's no change. No disappearance of pink color of KM4. So this is saturated compound. Now you add in test tube B. Is there any change? We have to shake it. Shake this. Yes, there is a change of color. You see, disappearance of pink color of KM4. So what we will get, the inference is that the compound is unsaturated. And when KM4 reacts with unsaturated compounds as alkene oil, oxidizes carbon-carbon double to give alkane diols, okay, glycol type compound, and the carbon-carbon triple bond to give carboxylic acid. The pink color permanganate is destroyed in the brown precipitate of MnO2 produced. Okay, this is the Bayer's test. Now I will show you functional group test. Now for this functional group test, I will first show you this alcohol. Functional group, I am selecting here alcohol. And the test selecting is sodium metal test. The procedure is that you have to take about 1 ml of the given liquid in a dry test tube and about 1 gram of anhydrous calcium sulfate. Here it is, anhydrous calcium sulfate, and shake well to remove water. Then after that, we have to filter the liquid into another clean dry test tube and add a small piece of sodium metal. Now you see. The procedure for this one, you go through this and you see. For this functional group preparation, see procedure. Here, I am taking the help. Then just spatula of the test tube A to A anhydrous this one. This I am taking this anhydrous and giving here. Okay. Now we have to add this. Then I will filter this. Going to the next part. For the yellow, I will take sodium metal here. I'm taking one sodium metal. Then dry it. The help of another filter paper. I have dried it and I will take this sodium metal and I will give here. You see, effervescence are coming. Then what happened? Alcohol reacts with acid metal like sodium to produce effervescence due to the liberation of hydrogen gas. Yes, so you see, this is the functional group detection process. Okay, this is the test, is the sodium metal test. Here I am giving here sodium metal. So you see the effervescence coming. So here is the alcoholic group. Now we can test for phenol also. For phenol, we are testing litmus test. First, we will do a lot of tests. You see, ferric chloride test, Lieberman test, phthalein dye test. So, now I will show you only one test. This is litmus test. Here is the litmus paper. I am taking moist blue litmus and I am giving the sample here. Here I am giving the sample. What you see? Phenol is a weak acid, so it turns the color of blue litmus paper red. How I have done this? I have taken a blue litmus paper and I am giving the sample here. You can see the change of color. If it is a acid, then blue litmus should be red. Okay, this is the test for phenol. Now I am going to the aldehyde test. There are a lot of tests. It is Tollens reagent test, Fehling test. There are a lot of tests for this aldehyde group. You can see for ketone. For ketone, there are a lot of tests. This is sodium bisulfate test, metadinitro benzene test, sodium nitroprusside test. There are lots of tests you can run here. Same procedure. If you are not aware of this one, then go to the help, then they will provide you the way. Go to the next carboxylic acid. Again, in litmus test, I am showing here this litmus test. I am taking a litmus paper for carboxylic acid. It is an acid, so I am giving here the change of color. You see, this is the red color is showing, so it is an acid. You can confirm this one with this test. Then, going to the amines, solubility test, we can run solubility test, and all of this you can run with this way, with the help of this website. Now you see, I'm going to, these are all about the functional group test, you see, and now I will show you another experiment. I'm going to home again, and here you see, going to the chemistry part. And again, I will show you a simple part. This is purification of impure samples by crystallization. Crystallization also in one of the important application of this synthetic organic chemistry. So, what is crystallization? The theory is that what happened in crystallization? It is the most important. Crystallization is important. That is why. Coming to the impurity part. So, what happened during crystallization? The chemical used for various purposes should be pure. We have to use pure chemicals, completely free from any type of impurities. Okay. Method of purification of a substance depends upon the nature of impurities present in it. Method of purification depends on mainly the nature of impurities. What type of impurities are present? Then we have to choose the method of purification. There are various method for the purification of substances. For example, filtration, evaporation, distillation, crystallization. I am going to crystallization. Crystallization is one of the very, very important purification technique. Purifying substance by removing unwanted byproducts. Crystalline compounds are finally purified via this crystallization process. The principle behind crystallization. What is the principle behind crystallization? In crystallization, the impure substance is dissolved in a suitable solvent to reach its nearly saturated solution at a temperature of higher than that of the room temperature. In room temperature, we cannot do the crystallization. What we will do at this high temperature, the solute has very high solubility in the solvent. So, a much smaller quantity of hot solvent is needed for dissolving the solute than the solvent at room temperature. When the solution is cooled, the pure substance is crystallized. The solution left behind is called mother liquor. At the impurities, all the impurities are left behind in the mother liquor. The purification method depends on the differences in solubility between the compound and the impurity. We can discuss this process also. I will show you crystallization part. One crystallization process I will show you. I will show you the crystallization of copper sulfate. Okay, I am going to the simulator. And internet is slow, is showing very slow. Now see, for the crystallization of copper sulfate, what we will do? present in the copper sulfate solution, we can remove by filtration. The filtrate is concentrated to the crystallization point. How we will concentrate? We have to heat. We have to increase the temperature and then we have to cool it. On cooling, transparent blue crystal of copper sulfate separates. The copper sulfate crystal formed has triclinic shape. Go to the your book about the shapes of the crystal. Now I will show you the procedure how I will do the crystallization of copper sulfate. Now select the sample. Here you see, select the sample. In this we have to select copper sulfate. Here I am selecting copper sulfate. Now what we will do? What we will do? You see, for this procedure, I am selecting this copper sulfate. I am taking this copper sulfate. First, I have to choose this copper sulfate and you have to this spatula and we have to take it out, the copper sulfate, and keep it here and give here. We have to add this sulfuric acid. Then, drag the spatula to stir the solution and take the measuring cylinder and give this sulfuric acid and again go to the next. You see, we will filter this and go to the next. What we will do? We will heat the compound. I am heating this one. Now what we will do, we will keeping here. Sorry. Okay. This we have to keep here. Then we have to keep this for cooling. Take your time. Crystals come up. Okay, here is the crystals. Next, we have to. Here is the ethyl alcohol with water. Then, here, crystalline is an upper solution. Here, you see. Going to the next, what we will get? The world's glass contain dried crystals. Again, I am showing what I will do. Again, I will show you the simulator part. Again, I will show you. First, you have to take copper sulfate here. And here it is already distilled water. We have to dissolve it. And we have to add sulfuric acid here. Next, what we will do? We will filter this. Then what we will do, we have to heat it. For heating, we have to switch on the burner and dissolve it. We are taking out here, we are keeping this in a glass bowl and we are keeping here for cooling. Now you see that we are taking it out and going to the next part. We will wash it with ethyl alcohol and with cold water. You have to wash this. Here, going to the next, here is the, these are the crystals of copper sulfate. And these are all about the theory part and this simulator.
your part, how you can do in your own PC, in your home, how you can do this virtual lab, how you can make your home as a laboratory. Is there some of the applications I am showing? And there are a lot of websites, as you are aware, from day onwards, they are resource persons and honorable chief guests, they are giving information about the different types of labs, about 100 labs are there, virtual labs are there. You have to go to this lab and you have to search and log on to this lab. You can log on here also, OLab, VLab, ProxyLab, and you can go through it and go to this chemistry or whatever you want, biology, physics, maths, English, whatever you want, you go. I am from chemistry background, so I am showing you this chemistry part. Yeah, if some other students are there from other part, then you can go to your own part and you can see all the experiments are giving properly here. You can do anything. You can do this. You can read this theory part. You can see the procedure, how they are doing this, all these things. You can see this animation also, where they are giving some animated videos of all these practicals. You can see this one if you want to see this. And simulator, you can do in your own PC. You can do all these things there. Video, Viva also there. And lot of resources also there. And lot of things are there. You can learn with the help of this lab, and I think this will be very helpful for not only the students, for the teachers and other research scholars also. This will be helpful for us, and it is the most important thing in this during this pandemic conditions. We are suffering a lot. Maybe the students are suffering a lot. So we are doing the online classes, but we are unable to do the laboratory as Professor Porijos Mondal sir have already told all these things. I don't want to explain again. So I am just trying to show you some of the application part of this chemistry laboratory and what we are doing in undergraduate level. That is a lot of experiments are there. You can try in your home with the help of this laboratory, as Jatin sir in the first day he told about the resources. Mainly we have to improve our resources. Actually we have to improve our internet connections and all that. We need all this all these things, but we can try, we can do all these things by giving a little bit of support. And if you need any help, so I am basically telling to the students, if you need any kind of help, or we can we are always be for you. We are always there for you at any time. And that's all about my here I would like to finish my session actually here. Over to Porinda ma'am. Hello.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Sinki Kolita, for your valuable presentation on application of virtual laboratory for C2D chemistry. Thank you. She has presented on chromatographic techniques and highlights on synthetic chemistry. She has also presented various tests for functional groups, preparation of organic compounds, purification, etc. I must compliment Dr. Singhi Kolita for her presentation on test for functional groups, which are day-to-day laboratory practicals for EUG course. Specifically, for the acetylation process, since nowadays acetic anhydride is not available in the market, so though it is a very important practical for EUG students, so students can now be able to carry on this practical through Thursday platform. I hope all the students can now carry on this acetylation process. Other processes generally we have already done in our physical lab, such as benzylation or etc. But acetylation is nowadays not done due to the lack of these chemicals, acetic anhydride. So thank you very much, Sinki. Now the session is going to an end. Before winding up, I would like to thanks, sincere thanks to our principal sir for his, without his support, this interesting workshop is not able to visualize. I would also express my deep sense of gratitude to distinguished speaker, Professor Paritosh Mandal sir. My sincere thanks to Dr. Singhi Kolita. I also express my heartiest thanks to all the organizers. At last, but not the least, I would like to thank all the participants, without which this workshop would have not been possible, successful. We are looking forward for the morning session tomorrow at 10:45 a.m., which will be on practice session for chemistry virtual lab. There will also be a second session tomorrow at 2:45 p.m., which include chemistry and English. For chemistry session, the speaker will be Dr. Debojit Bora. So, research person will be Dr. Debojit Bora. So, hope all the participants will be available tomorrow also. So, thank you once again. Thanks to all. Okay, Vinod?
Yeah.
May I wind up now? Is it okay?
Okay.
Hello,
thank Vinod? You. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, thank you all.
Thanks to all once again.